Hello, I'm Luis de Matos, and this is the Wizard Product Review.
It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday, and this is the Wizard Product Review. I'm Dave.
I'm Craig.
I'm Paul Daniels, and unfortunately, he hasn't got his hands over his mouth. Sorry about that.
We are here with the legend that is Paul Daniels. I think... The most famous magician we've ever had as a guest on the Wizard Product Review. That's not up for debate, really.
By
is it?
Far, the yeah, absolutely, completely. I can't even think what to say. To be perfectly honest,
do you want the money now?
Just... off camera would be better.
And we're genuinely nervous. Quite a lot of people. A comment we get when they come on the Wizard Product Review, Paul, is they're a little bit intimidated by myself and Craig.
I'm not. Don't worry about that.
I know you're not. And,
I'm definitely not.
I can assure you that the feeling is very much reversed today.
I've never seen David Penn nervous up until moment.
John, and blushing.
John, can we say, who was it that when we walked up to the door, I rang the doorbell, Craig was like, "You stand there, Dave." Trying to arrange how we stood just to create that first impression before we met.
You're the reason master. Why
well,
you were standing, magicians.
You were standing in the wrong order, I'll tell you that, yeah. Now, it's quite funny, this, because it happens if I go to a magic convention and some stupid organizer will say, you know, we're having a competition or we're having the show, whatever, and we've put you right in the front. I go, no, don't do that, because the guys freak out, and I don't get it. I just don't get it, because I can remember many, many years ago, my dear, oh yes, many years ago, I when I was still allowed into Blackpool, and I went to the Blackpool convention to do a show for them. Very early days for me. I mean, really early. I was known in the clubs, but nobody knew me in the magic scene. And I got like your feeling. I got a bit nervous. I don't get nervous normally. And I'm thinking, oh, what am I going to do? I don't do anything magicians like. You know, they want the latest move. They want the latest gimmick and all that. And I don't do that stuff. I do stuff that everybody else has thrown out. And so... I remember I was following an Irish magician, and he got one of those Jack Hughes carousels that went round. He produced doves and put them on, you know. And I did a racist gag. I was watching him, and he was in the wrong suit. He was the wrong shape to be doing doves. And I just thought, what am I nervous about? If these guys were any good in the audience, they'd be working, wouldn't they? And so I walked on and took the mickey, like I do normally anyway. And I just said, did you see that guy, the Irish magician, putting doves on a carousel? They're Irish doves. They're already dizzy, you know. And it just, I was away. I was having time. So you must never be nervous until I do this. Anyway, yes.
That'll do it.
Well, the reason we're here today is, Luis de Matos is paying you a lot of money, apparently. To sit down with us and talk about your new release. So what is the title of the release of the century?
Bravura.
And for the uneducated...
David's very uneducated. He doesn't understand what that means. I do, but obviously
you're probably just looked it up on Wikipedia or something, be honest.
Yeah.
You could. It's a proper word. I mean, it's a peculiar kind of courage. Do you remember John Fisher wrote a book, A Funny Way to Be a Hero, about comedians who just walk out to a microphone, you're on their own, they're facing the madding throng. And it was called Funny Way to Be a Hero. Well, that's a kind of bravura. It's courage. Yeah, that's it, simplistically.
And courage is what you need these days, do you think, if you're going to sort of be an entertainer?
I think you always did.
Yeah.
I think you always did, yeah.
What made you decide to release it? I never thought that you would ever release your... I mean, this is what has made you a legend. The stuff on this DVD set is it's what you've done day in, day out. It's what you've made your reputation on.
Mm.
Why would you now... release that so that other magicians can start doing it?
Because I'm 76. You don't look it. No, I know I don't. But I'm 76, and in my life, I've lost good friends. Ali Bongo, the incredible Gillini, who was a hidden voice in the world of magic. He used to make props for Will Goldston and Lyle, you know, and I had him on my team because I loved the guy. And I kept on to him, you know, you've got to write the book, you've got to put this stuff down, and this, that, and the other. Well, he died, and all that knowledge had gone. Now, unfortunately, in the world of magic, and you've got to remember, I mean, you really have got to remember this, that magic's got so many different facets and faces, but the main one is there's the hobbyists, and I use the word amateur properly, it's a lover of the game, you know, and there's the pros. And it really is a completely different world.
Yeah.
It really is. There are one or two amateurs who might be able to stand up and work as a pro, but they don't really realize all the business behind it. They don't realize the plotting, the planning, the months of preparation and all that jazz. So, and you've got to know your business. Now, in my case, my act, which has been, you know, stolen in its entirety and performed badly, has a lot of hidden psychology behind it. It has, and I wanted to get out there, the reasons behind every little detail. See, I would love, I've got thousands of magic books, but I haven't got one that tells me how Kalanag lit the levitation to hide the cables, you know? I haven't got one that tells me that detail. I want to know that detail. So I decided with what had become known in the world of magic as the most entertaining cabaret act of all time.
Yeah.
It wasn't accidental. It was deliberate. So much in that when you watch that and listen to it, if you listen to the detail and not just learn the tricks, you know, I mean, for Christ's sake, what's to learn tricks? It's a waste of time. But you can do, with this study, it should make you think about what you're doing in the detail that I applied to what I did.
Was there any part, as Craig mentions, there's so many routines that are explained on here, two that come to mind immediately, obviously the chop cut routine, your electric chairs routine. Was there any part where you were sat down and you were explaining this stuff, and in the back of your mind, you were actually thinking, I can't believe I'm actually doing this. I can't believe I'm putting this information out there. Did it feel uncomfortable at all?
Not really. The real secret of magic is never, ever the trick.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to get out there to magicians to make them better entertainers. I hate it when the press come at me. Well, how do you describe yourself? Are you a magician or an entertainer? That's an insult to magic,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah.
But understandable when you go to conventions and watch a lot of the guys. And then when you watch a good one, you think, why is he better? He's just doing the same trick that I bought last year.
Okay, for anybody watching, I want to ask you a question now that I've been thinking about this interview for a few days, and I maybe you could give some advice for people out there.
Certainly.
And
never leave your money in the dressing room.
That's a good one. But we came to see your show. I brought my family along. We came to see it in the Gordon Craig Theatre in Stevenage.
Which one?
I can't remember. Show? It was the very last one you did, the live tour.
Oh, well, that was interesting, because in that one, we threw out the chop cup, we threw out the chairs, we threw out everything,
it was
the walnut.
It was all new material. What you don't know about that night, actually, my stepdaughter's 9 years old, and I had a good feeling that you might pick her for the Linking Rings, which you did, and it wasn't set up. All the way in the car, we were practicing two jokes, because I know your routine where you say, I'm going to go and get the rings, you tell the audience a joke. And I was so disappointed that she froze on stage and didn't tell these jokes that we rehearsed. But anyway, let me get back to the original question, because I'm digressing. One thing that I always admire about you, as well as so many things, is when you walk onto a stage, that moment you walk out, you are instantly likable.
Mm-hmm. And everybody, yeah, everybody loves you the moment you walk out. And it's not because of the years on television, because my partner hadn't seen you on television. Celinda wasn't aware of you because she was a little bit too young. I've taken her along. But they loved you the moment you walked out. Can you offer any words of wisdom to anybody to create that moment?
Even that is in bravura.
That's in it as well. Anything now you can give away.
Even
give away.
That is in bravura. It's a technique that I observed. American stars did it very early on. And it's, well, it all comes from really knowing what you're doing. I think that nerves and nervousness, there's two things apart to it. The main thing is they can smell it in the dressing room. The audience know.
Yeah.
So the audience start to worry for you. It's like I say again, in bravura, I'm sure I said this. I watch magicians and the table wobbles a bit. And I can feel the audience around me go, right? Yeah. And the schmo up on stage has no idea he's starting to lose us,
yeah,
you know? So I have very solid tables, you know? I mean, mine's a block, isn't it? You know, yeah, it ain't going to go no place. Also, I know all about lighting, sound systems, theatre, which side of the stage to deliver right comment from and wrong comment from and all that, because I studied theatre. And so, when I walk onto the stage, I'm not nervous at all. I know Barack Obama's going to be in power tomorrow and the coalition will, yeah, be saying that Gary shouldn't give his OBE back, you know, or he'd be called, if he gives his OBE back, he'd be called Gary Alu. Anyway, and so stuff like that. And so I'm very, very relaxed and I want to be there.
Yeah.
You know, I want to be there. And nothing's going to go wrong. Yeah, and if it does, I'll deal with it.
There's this feeling, whatever you're going to do, you are in control and you're kind of reassured that it's going to be great.
Yeah.
And it's almost like in one moment, you relax and say, I'm going to enjoy this.
Seconds.
Whereas we saw another show, which I won't mention, that was another touring magic show, and they didn't enjoy that as much, even though a lot more had been thrown at the budget and the production.
Mm-hmm.
But my family members loved and enjoyed your show so much more.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I would quite like to direct more magic shows. I mean, oddly enough, Debbie and I were flown out to America to direct a magic show. And it's a bit embarrassing that you're on the plane saying, hey, what are we going to do? You know, if it's really terrible, you know, if these people can't cut it, you know, yeah, and all that jazz. And the one that springs to mind is one of the best magic shows I've ever seen with certainly, I can't talk about my wife on this, but the best assistant I've ever watched. And that's the Rick Wilcox show. And magicians don't know who the hell I'm talking about. But the Rick Wilcox show is in a place called Wisconsin Dells. Great, great family magic show that entertains from square one to the end. Highly recommended. Yeah.
Fantastic. And
but I'd like to do more of that. You know, I'd like, because as you say, you went to see a magic show and I can tell you now it was bitty. It didn't finish up in the right order, did it? It ended with the weakest trick.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah.
See? And now you're wondering, how the hell does he know? Because I haven't told him. But I have the power. You see? Forget it, Darren. Well, I'm here.
Well, of course, a lot of...
He does a good show.
A lot of... excellent. Yeah, absolutely excellent. If you... You know, talking about tricks, which obviously is covered in the DVD release, your effects have become modern classics.
Yeah.
But not only of yours, I think magic in general. When people talk about the Chop Cup, your name will always come up. Electric chairs, your name will always come up. But if I said to you now, it's sort of like desert island tricks was the sort of theme of this question. If you could only take one close-up effect, one sort of stage effect, and one grand illusion, Which of those three things would you kind of take with you if you were going to a desert island? And literally, that was it. That was all you could perform, even though there's probably no audience there. But, you know, which of those do you really feel attached to?
Well, you know, you have to start to think about your audience. There'd be Man Friday, wouldn't there? He'd be there.
He'd be there,
you know?
Yeah.
So it'd be useless doing the show on Saturday. He'd be gone. And the, what would I do? If I was to pick a close-up trick, it would have to be from two. I have, and we sell it on the show, the ultimate self-working card tricks.
Right.
There is a trick on that first disc, which when I saw it, it's funny, over the years you develop an instinct for, yeah, that's too good, you know? And so I've done it, and I in my entire life, I've been doing magic now 65 years.
Wow.
And I've never known a reaction from the public greater than you get from that card trick where you say you're going to teach them how to cheat. And you finish up with the four kings, and they finish up with the four races, and it's just self-working.
I know the one. It's the one where you're teaching them how. You say, I'm going to teach you the bottom deal, middle deal. All that rubbish.
Yeah. It is rubbish, isn't it, that bit? But, yeah. But at the end of the day, when they turn those you will never get a greater reaction.
Do you think you touched on something there? Do you think it engages the public because of the hook that you're saying, I'm going to teach you how to cheat?
It's the complete trick. Yeah. I mean, it involves you, the audience, it involves them doing it, and at the end of it, it's such a killer surprise, because they can't remember the detail, and it's all, they've done it, and so it's magic on them, but you have the power.
So that's close-up stage routine?
A stage routine that you mean that isn't in my regular repertoire?
Well, anything you want.
That
it sticks out is for you. We know you for the chairs, but this is about what you think.
Yeah, the problem you just put it on there is there's only me there, and so the phantom switch that I designed. I'm very proud of that. It fooled, Scott Penrose was involved in it once because we had to do, we did a show up in Edinburgh to commemorate Lafayette. And I decided to do the Phantom. And he just couldn't believe the switch. The switch is unique and it's mine, so that was good. But there's nobody else there to do it with. So what would I do? I would probably, because I could, I would have to rebuild, because I can't imagine the shipwreck would bring those three boxes of floating in. I'd probably do a Zany Blaney style levitation.
Yeah.
And I know he does the chair, the ladder one, and that's the one that David does, Copperfield.
Yeah.
And I've always wanted to call a rabbit David Hopperfield. Anyway, it's just it's the only illusion I ever bought that when I bought it, it was perfect. There was nothing else to do, and I just got the one with the two trestles, I guess you call them.
Yeah.
And the white hoop.
Yeah.
I prefer actually the white hoop in its action, but it's But that is for me, it was perfect. It was the perfect illusion. And so, and I love the new gag I put in on it. I put a new gag in on it where the girl is standing, she's standing. She's laid there and I'm standing behind her. And I say, now, you're going up into the air. You're rising into the air. And really, I'm bending my knees and going down. A mad idea I had one night, but it just kept going and going and going, you know. And slowly it dawns on the audience, and it's lovely to hear that ripple of laughter going away as one by one they all work on it. Yeah, really good.
I've got a quick question. You've been on TV for years and years and years and years and years. You've done thousands and thousands of tricks.
Mm.
What's your favourite thing that you've ever done on? My personal favourite was, and I remember this, and this just blew me away, was when you made the camera. disappear, the vanishing camera, when the cameraman's camera and just in the box and just, I remember,
it's actually an iconic piece
I of just remember really being, that moment kind of making me go, because I wasn't into magic at that point, I was just watching you as, and I was like, I need to know how that works. And I think that was the moment where I decided I wanted to get into magic. Just, it blew me away. That.
Yeah, it was good, that. There was no doubt about it. That was a real goodie. Which would I say? I think that became one for the trade. Everywhere we went in the world, we'd walk into a studio somewhere and the cameraman would say, oh, pretty tummy, what happened to the camera? You know, well, I am not telling you, I'm totally buffered by the camera trick. You know, everywhere we went, all these different people. So that was good. But in terms of invention, I think the final version of the kettle that poured the drinks, because four people came out of the audience, sat down, they weren't pre-stooged, there was no queuing on stage or anything, they really did not say their drinks out loud, they really did think a drink, and that was the title from Hoffman, Think a Drink Hoffman, and they thought of the drink and they poured it out. And I thought of that when I was watching the previous transmission of it. Why didn't I do that? So I had to wait a couple of years and do it again. Mm-hmm. But certainly in the mind of the public, that was a massive trick.
I remember everyone
to
talking about that.
Yeah.
Well, mine was the vanishing elephant, was it? Johnny Morris. That was my personal favourite.
Do you know the story of that?
Well, I don't.
Well, John Fisher came at me. We're sitting in a planning meeting and... what about vanishing an elephant? So I said, well, you know, you do it like this, you do it. And I came all the standard, with no disrespect at all, Vegas methods, you know, because I knew them all. And he said, no. He said, typical John, I want to do it outside, in a field. Well, what we could do is kill that phone, which is up there. So
we'll just... You're just too popular on Twitter, that's what it is.
Yeah, it is. It's not me. That's not me. Too. It's probably my manager. Tell him I'm fully booked. And so, so what happened was John said he wanted it in the field. So I started to think of things like an aha. Do you know what an aha is? It's an aha. It's in stately homes. You can see the sheep grazing out there, but what you can't see is the field slopes down.
Right.
And then there's a wall. And then the garden, so it just blends in, and they can't get up. He wanted it in a football field. And so I said, well, the only way I can think of, and this is what I do this for shows, for pantomimes, and anybody comes at me with a problem, I have a brain that after 65 years of reading just goes, pow, there's the answer. And I drew it all up. I said, very expensive.
Yeah.
And I went on holiday. Well, I came back a couple of months later and he called another planning meeting and there we all were. And he said, now, Paul, all the technicians, tell them about the vanishing elephant. And I said, which one? And Gildini says, yours. I said, you're not going to do that, are you? And he said, yeah, right. So they did it. The fabulous Bobby Roberts, the greatest elephant man of them all, and it was so sad that one of his staff was cruel to an elephant and Bobby got the blame. He brought an elephant down, Maureen it was, who he'd saved from being shot in a zoo. And we got it all set up and we put a camera on Johnny Morris, who at that time had been doing all these animal voices, to get his reaction. And when the tent fell apart...
I can still remember that today.
And that we had the tallest crane in Europe lift the top off, and it wasn't... a camera angle, you know, perspective thing and all that. We couldn't show what Johnny said because it was very obvious what he said when it went. The next week, I meet Bert Whedon, King of the Guitars. He was a lovely man, he was. And he's the guy who a lot of our top bands started with, you know, the Plain of Day book. And he said, what happened to the elephant, Paul? I said, I can't tell you that. and he was a brother water rat, that's a show business charity. And, oh, come on, Paul, tell me that. And his wife said, Paul, tell him, we're not sleeping. We're not sleeping. He keeps waking up, going downstairs, watching it again. He's not sleeping. So it went on and on. Debbie, tell me when it, tell me, what happened to the elephant? Because she was on it when it went, you know. And I said, he said, on my deathbed, tell me. And I said, she won't do that. He said, why not? Well, you might get better. And so there was that. And then I waited 2 years and designed the whole show around this bloody elephant. And so it was a Christmas show where the show was designed to look like my house at the time.
Yeah, remember that?
Yeah. We did it all, and I had Bert Whedon in, and we did spirit paintings, and he played Candle in the Wind, because someone in the audience chose Marilyn Monroe, and the spirit painting came. Wonderful. And I said to him, do you know why you're here, Bert? Bert was such a lovely guy. To play the guitar, he now knows why he's been locked in his dressing room all the time. And he says, play the guitar. I said, no, you're here for this. And the whole set.
Whole set went away, back wall of the studio, yeah,
everything.
Yeah.
Bare studio, concrete floor, audience, come on down, stomp on the ground, make sure it's all solid. And Bert's going, what is going on? And up there we had a frame with a furled silk tent on it. And got everybody to hold the tent. I said, what's the one thing you're always asking me, Bert? What? About the elephant? Oh, yeah. Where'd the elephant went? Here. And it went up. And we had a camera on him, and he said exactly the same thing as Johnny said when it went. Couldn't show that either.
Well, before we sort of wrap this interview up, I think this has been the quickest half hour ever on the Wizard product review.
Was it only half an hour?
What would you like people to get from your DVD release, when they've got it, when they buy it, when they watch it, what would you personally like people to take away from it?
A couple of things I'd really like them to take away: that there's a hell of a lot more to magic than just how the trick works.
Yeah,
I mean, so many people have said it. That's a fact. That it isn't the magic trick. It's always the actor presenting it.
Yeah.
Always. Male or female, makes no odds to me. Or transgender, I don't care. It's always you. And then, hopefully, that having watched all the thought and the thinking and the psychology and the stagecraft, that you stop and think, whoa, I'm just doing tricks. I've got to do more, you know? And you can. And it's fun. I mean, it ain't hard work. It's a fabulous hobby. I get paid for playing with my toys.
And if you could hold on to that as well, Craig. We've got something here as well for anybody that buys your DVD set or pre-orders it and gets it. We were hoping that you could sign something for us. And I'll go and get it, actually. This is a sort of genuine Ken Brook chop cup, and it looks very, very similar. It's got all the original instructions, and I was hoping that you could sign that, and we're going to get it framed up with the very first copy of your DVD release. Luis de Matos is sending us that copy, and he's allowed us to frame that, but we just need the final part of the puzzle. Would you mind signing that particular chop cup?
Yeah. And then, no, but what I will do, as soon as we come off air, as it were, what I'll do is I'll get an engraving tool and I'll engrave it.
Wow.
We are in his workshop, right?
It's going to be engraved, right, okay.
It'd be better than that, because that might wipe off. But with
can we get the instructions signed?
Yeah, that'll be an extra £4.50.
There you go. Sign the instructions now. Get the instructions signed. Okay. Get it beautifully framed.
Well, Paul's signing this, I just want to remind people that you are back on tour.
Yeah. This one's going to be called Paul Daniels and Debbie McGee. Back despite popular demand. I couldn't resist it. Everybody was expecting it to be the second farewell tour. That's why, you know. Shirley Bassey.
That's awesome.
Take that to a chemist, they'll make it up for you. Take the pills 3 times a day.
Absolutely fantastic. There it is. And right after the show is finished, Paul's going to engrave the chop cup as well, which is fantastic.
It's a trick, Ben. It's got a magnet in it. It's got a...
Paul, right, I can't believe that we're here today. And
unbelievable. I think it's the quietest I've ever been on this show, ever.
Seriously, it's all, anybody that knows me personally, it's all I could do to hold it together today. And I've not been my normal self on camera because this means so much to me personally to interview you today. It's been worth...
You don't have to say
3 years.
Just pay me.
It's been worth 3 years on the Wizard product review, yep, getting up sometimes absolutely 5 o'clock to go and review magic products, to have that position in the magic community.
And you have no idea how many times I've disagreed with you.
Well, yeah, everybody's join entitled to the their club own opinion. That's and you're in great company there. But yeah, just all those 3 years, just to give us this opportunity to come and interview you today.
It's a real
so
honor.
Thank you
seriously
very much, Paul.
It's been a pressure. Pleasure, pleasure. I got it wrong again.
We'll see you next week on the Wizard Product Review when probably he'll just be back to being me and Craig. Thank you so much to the master, to the greatest British magician of all time, my favourite magician, Paul Daniels.